and across, flapping his ears a little bit as he goes. Those are like giant air conditioning units for elephants. It packed hundreds and hundreds of capillaries within those almost paper-thin-like ears compared to the rest of his body. And by moving them, flapping them around, he loses heat very rapidly through them. And that's one of the ways in which such a large animal is able to live in an area where the climate is so incredibly warm. It's also lovely to be seeing elephants eating grass again. This is the first time we've really seen them this rainy season eating grass. And it's because we are in the grips of a rather fierce drought that has essentially reduced the grass growth to almost nothing this particular year. Luckily, we've had a little bit of rain towards the end of our rainy season, just before we go into our dry season. And that's actually given us some, or given the animals rather, some grass for them to feed on. Go forward a little bit, see if we can't get a nicer view of the rest of the herd that are slowly making their way towards us. Well, they will have spent the hottest part of the day in some relatively thick bush, just hiding out in the shade and feeding. Well, we are incredibly fortunate to be able to see and interact with these incredible animals. Ryan, you wanted to know, what is the most unusual or rare animal that we see or could see in this reserve? And Ryan, we've got quite a few different species, but the one that immediately springs to mind is something called a pangolin. The pangolin looks very much like an armadillo, and it is one of the most poached and trafficked animals in the entire world. I haven't seen one in this particular area yet, although I do know of people that have, and I've only ever seen two in my entire life in the wild. A very, very exciting little animal to see. And I'll show you a picture in a moment, Ryan. Here we go. That is what a pangolin looks like. Very bizarre looking creature, nocturnal and an insect eater. And those scales around its body are very, very sharp. And long claws for digging out and some termites. Look at him having a scratch. Someone's got a very itchy ear. I spoke about elephants cooling themselves down, and Zach would like to know what the usual temperature is during the day and during the evening. Zach, in midsummer, our temperatures, particularly this year, have been incredibly high, so that we've been sitting with days between about 35 degrees to about 40, 45 degrees centigrade, which is about, if I do my rough sort of calculations, it's around 92 to over 100 degrees Fahrenheit. And it doesn't get much cooler during the night. It very seldom drops below 86 degrees Fahrenheit, which equates to about 30 degrees centigrade here. That's in midsummer. In winter, the days are much, much cooler and can drop very close to 0 degrees centigrade, which is about 32 in Fahrenheit. But that's during the night and first thing in the morning. And that's when you'll see all of us bulking up in scarves and jackets and beanies and gloves. Because if you factor in the wind chill factor of driving in an open vehicle, it really definitely adds to a drop in temperature. Isn't he beautiful? He's wandering about on the outskirts, which is very common behavior for male elephants of this particular age. John was saying, will an elephant, a male elephant, leave the herd if he can't find a mate? John, male elephants at around sort of 15 years old, give or take, are actually, won't just instinctively leave their herd, they are actually actively kicked out by the females of that herd. And the reason they do that is because every member of an elephant herd is related in some way, whether they be sisters, aunts, cousins, etc. So they don't want him, once he does reach sexual maturity, they don't want him breeding with the females of that herd. And they've devised a very clever system of essentially reducing the risk of inbreeding. So at about 15 years old, they will head off and lead a life that is large or can be largely solitary. They'll also join up because they're a little bit nervous, as you can imagine. They've spent their whole lives in this herd structure, and now all of a sudden, they're all on their own. So what they will do is they will join up with other young males of a similar age and go off in search of potential mating opportunities with herds elsewhere. And they can move incredibly far distances in order to do that. Once they reach about 30 years old and they're really mature bulls, they spend quite a long time on their own. But that doesn't mean that you never see big males in a herd. Sometimes they just happen to be in the same area as a group of females, a breeding herd of youngsters as well, as we have here. And they quite happily will join up for a couple, maybe a couple of hours, maybe even a couple of days. Because ultimately, elephants are highly sociable creatures. Hello, little one. So, for example, we've got this young bull here that is still part of the herd. He's reaching his teenage years, over 10 years old. And soon he will be off on his own and having to fend for himself. For now, though, he has the protection of his mum and his older sisters and his aunts. Now, elephants have personalities. I strongly, very firmly believe that, having had many close encounters with them, there's a huge level of intelligence. But that doesn't mean that you don't get the odd elephant that is a little bit more aggressive, and they like to push or throw their weight around every now and again. Nikea, you were wondering, have I ever seen an elephant attack another animal? And yes, I have. I've never seen it go through to the point that an elephant has killed another animal, although I have seen video clips of such things. It was, for example, that very the video that went viral a couple of weeks ago of an elephant attacking and killing a buffalo. I've seen them chase impala. I have seen them chase buffalo. I've seen them chase birds. And in fact, speaking of buffalo, there is actually one moving away from this elephant herd. He's hiding there in between the trees. Look really carefully. You'll see him moving. At the moment, he's just a shape in the leaves. And that is a buffalo bull trying to get away from these elephants, or just move away from these elephants. And particularly during drought seasons, it makes the elephants somewhat more on edge than they might usually be. And we very frequently see them chasing other animals away from the waterhole. Now, there's one animal out here, and it actually goes back to one of the question about the most unusual animal to see. And there's one animal that elephants really do not like, and that is wild dogs. Now, wild dogs are our most endangered predator in this particular area. There are under 500 left in South Africa, and there's 194 in this park, and that's the biggest population anywhere in South Africa. And their population is probably about 4,000 odd in the entire Africa, or on the entire African continent. A beautiful social predator, very complex and much more geared towards stamina chasing rather than the ambush of big cats, so waiting, creeping, stalking. Wild dogs just run, which has given them a terrible reputation as livestock killers, which is one of the reasons that they don't, or they have been so persecuted. But elephants really don't appreciate the presence of wild dogs close to them, and they will go out of their way to chase them. Never catch them. Wild dogs are far too fast for that. And Zach was wondering if anybody lives in the park and how we stay safe at night. Zach, I'm sitting probably about less than 100 meters from the house that I live in. We stay safe by being careful, but it's important to remember that we're not on anybody's menu out here. There's nothing that's going to set out to actively hunt or kill us. It's only rare accidental encounters when an animal has felt trapped and scared that results in either human injuries or human fatalities. As long as you treat these animals with respect, you will stay absolutely safe at night. Yes, there's lots of lodges, there's lots of guest camping sites. I would not advise sleeping out in the open in the bush. Definitely not on your own without keeping watch, because there are animals that might take advantage of that. But sleeping in a house or even sleeping in a tent is perfectly safe to do out here, as long as you know exactly what you're doing. And the Kruger National Park, which we are on the border of and open to, oh, yes, boy. Do you agree or disagree? Maybe he disagrees. He wants to tell me how big and scary he is. So, Riley, you were sort of wondering which area we are in. We're in the top sort of northeastern corner of South Africa in a place called the Greater Kruger National Park area. Now, we're on the western boundary. Sorry, I had to think about my east and west there for a second. We're on the western boundary, and I'm sure your teacher will be able to show you a map at some point, in a place called the Sabi Sands. And specifically in a tiny little section that we call our own and that we are able to drive around, known as Juma and Arethusa Game Reserves. But we are open to the Kruger National Park, and the Kruger National Park is a place that we can spend time, or that tourists can actually spend time, go into and drive themselves around amongst all of these wonderful wild creatures. Beefalo. Here we go. We have a buffalo in front of us, the one that I showed you earlier, moving across. Also one of the so-called Big Five. Now, this is an animal that one should pay plenty of respect to, especially a big bull like this. Over close to 2,000 pounds in weight. And in this particular case, looks like he's blind in his right eye. Unless the light is just hitting it strangely. No, maybe not. I think it might just be the light. Now, buffalo bulls are known for their somewhat, I wouldn't call it a grumpy temperament, but they don't appreciate being encountered on foot. That is one animal that one should be exceedingly respectful and cautious of. Although it looks like a big, slow, heavy cow, many of you will know about bison and the dangers that they can potentially pose. It's always important to remember that it is a wild animal. He's capable of covering a distance of 45 feet per second if he decides to at full speed, which is a speed that might actually even get the elephant chasing him. Here we go. Yeah, head flap. Although it was behind the trees, that elephant that just walked close to him flapped his head a little bit, just basically saying to that buffalo, hey, you stay away from me. Very commonly it's the young males that do stuff like that. Now, of course, there are other animals out here that would be exceptionally exciting to view. One of those is the biggest predator out here. And it seems as though Brent has gone looking for them. Let's see if he's found any evidence of their whereabouts.
So we came looking for a group of big male lions, and right there you can see their tracks. So if you see the front there, that's the front foot. Much, much bigger, and then the back foot has stepped on top of the thing. What looks like has happened here is they've been chased by elephants during the day. Unfortunately, they have been traced to the south of our traverse zone. But here we go, you can see a big male lion there. And of course, with these animals, with a lot of animals, the front foot is much bigger than the back foot. You must think they've got big heavy jaws and neck muscles to carry, or in the case of an elephant, tusks, or buffalo, horns. So you'll always find the front feet are quite often much bigger than the back feet. So we're going to continue on. So Jordan would like to know, who is the most prominent animal in the park and who is the top predator? Well, Jordan, the most prominent animal in the park is probably definitely the elephants, being the biggest. The most prolific animal in the park is the impala, and the top predator is, of course, the lion. And unfortunately, maybe they've been chased back, so we're going to have a quick look around these thickets here. see if we can find any more tracks and hopefully find you that lion. While we do that, let's jump back on board with Jamie.
I'm looking for a nice view of these elephants to show you. I've been hoping that they're going to come out and join us. Maybe even go across to one of the pans for a drink. I've also just rescued something that fell off our vehicle earlier. I had to sort of get the car as close as possible and lean backwards out of the door. Luckily, it is now safely on board. And even more excitingly, our elephants are starting to move out into the open. Look at the little one at the back. Not the youngest elephant calf I've seen, but it's still very sweet. Now, Ryan, as we watch these elephants feeding and moving past us, it's difficult perhaps to get a sense of their full scale, but you were wondering how long does it take for an elephant to reach its full size? And Ryan, the answer to that is they never stop growing. They grow continuously throughout their lives. There's a young one at the back. He is probably about 2.5 years old. Now, the most rapid growth in an elephant life happens in its first 5 years. And then after that, it continues to slow down as they grow older. But they can live up to 60 years old. Are you getting... I think this little one that's coming in on our left has just been pushed closer by an older male. Ryan, they can live up to 60 years old and they will continue to grow right up until the end of their lives. But the most rapid growth occurs when they are young, and then it slows down so that the amount that they are growing towards their end years is almost imperceptible. Their tusks will also continue to grow throughout their lives. So, Cole, you wanted to know, because we've got this elephant herd so beautifully close to us, you were saying, so animals are not afraid of people. It's a complex one, Cole. They're not afraid of us in our vehicles like this, no. All of these animals in the Sabi Sands, in the Great Kruger area, even some of the oldest elephants will have grown up experiencing vehicles and open safari vehicles with guests in the back, sitting and chatting about them. And in fact, to be completely honest, I even think that sometimes the youngsters find us highly entertaining, something to detract from their boredom whilst mom is feeding. We're as entertaining to them as they are to us. Oh, there's a tiny baby behind this female. That's a very young elephant. Look carefully at her back leg on the left side of your screen. Every now and again, you'll see its ears flapping. And its tiny little trunk that's reaching in the air, but never fear, it's going to come with her. There we go. Sorry, Cole, I haven't fully answered your question, but just have a look at this. Hello, little one. Tiny elephant, under a year old, for certain, just judging by that size. Fit perfectly under mom's stomach. Hello, little one. Isn't that precious? Look how disproportionately short that trunk is. When it does become more visible, you'll be able to see what I mean. Here's the trunk. And that's so that little elephant that hasn't quite learnt the coordination of using it yet, oh, having a scratch on mom's leg. That's so that little elephant doesn't trip over it, or so that it doesn't get in its way, because baby elephants have to learn to use their trunks like we have to learn to use our hands and our arms as young children. Cole, in answer to your question, yes, a lot of the time the animals are afraid of us, particularly on foot. And that is because they've had hundreds and thousands of years of evolution with us starting and then succeeding to become the dominant apex predator. It's okay, guys. Hello, mommy. Your baby's beautiful. I'm talking to the elephants not because they understand me. but because they understand the tone. Yes, gorgeous girl. Your baby is lovely. Yo. Hey, you're cute. Watch it run down this hill. Oh. After mom. Oh, sorry, head's in the way. The whole herd being guided by the gentle rumbles of the females telling the animals where to go. Here they go. Last straggling youngster at the back. And across they go. And I think they might go across down to one of the dams for a drink. I think that while they disappear into this thick vegetation, we might be able to get a view of them if we loop around. One last shot of our female elephant and her beautiful baby. This is a lovely mature cow. She's at least 35 years old or older. I would say even older. Now, in terms of size and strength, the elephants have the monopoly in that in this particular region. That being said, they've also got the protective unit of the numbers of the different elephants. Oh, goodness. Here's a trumpet. One of them got into each other's face. Gabriel, you were wondering what animal might harm an elephant. The only real answer to that is lions are probably the only predator capable of tackling an elephant, and only in exceptionally unusual circumstances. So there's a pride in Botswana that has been known to specialize in killing, picking off and killing young elephant bulls that have just moved to the outskirts of the herd, but only ever in situations where their food is at a bit of a premium and they're struggling. After that, the only other threat to elephants is us. We are the biggest threat to them, hands down, whether through poaching, habitat loss, interactions between or conflict between elephants and people regarding crops. Lots of, almost all wilderness areas now within Africa are surrounded to some extent by agricultural setups, so local communities that have farming. And a fence cannot stop an elephant. An elephant wants to go through a fence, it will go through a fence. Are big enough and intelligent enough to know how to handle it. And I'm afraid this will be our last view of this herd for now, since they are going to disappear into a thick block, all led by a female. A matriarchal system, a truly matriarchal system. So although the males are bigger and stronger than the females, it is the female-based unit of the herd that is so important to them. Led and guided by the oldest female, and usually the oldest female in the group. Sometimes it's her daughter when she gets to an age where she's a little bit too old to lead the herd. And she will decide where they go. She will discipline youngsters. She will teach the rest of the young females how to go about looking after calves and looking after the rest of the herd. And her memory will span back the entire lifespan of her life. We've come now to the end of our school drive. So, Mrs. Mykoff's class, it's been wonderful to have you on board. I hope that you keep watching. Don't forget, we do this twice a day, every day, and you'll be able to find out from your teacher information as to where you can watch it. Either way, I hope that you've enjoyed your afternoon and that you enjoy the rest of your school day further, and have a fantastic time. We'll see you on the back soon. Right, let us find out what Brent is up to.
So, unfortunately, those lions have evaded us, but that is what happens out in the bush. So they've headed off on a territorial patrol, and they will probably be heard roaring tonight. They have roared an incredible amount last night, and hopefully they'll be back in not too long. So at the moment, Jandre and I are going to go see if we can find a leopard, but probably not before you guys have to leave us. So we've got one last little thing to show you. And we're nearly there. And it was a buffalo skull that was killed by lions in August. And it has taken from August to now to be completely spread through the bush. Very few bones around and only the skull left. Here we go. Now that's all that's left of a big buffalo. in a few months out here in the bush. And it is a completely interconnected system where everything has its part. There's even one species of fish moth that eats the horns that no one else can eat. And slowly over time, between sun, porcupines, and whatnot, there's not even going to be a bone left because they'll chew on that for the calcium. But to Mrs. Wycroft's class, thanks for joining us. And don't forget, you can always join us when you're at home on Wild Safari Live. So have a great rest of your school day, and we're going to head off and see what else we can find. So, welcome to our regular viewers. Nice to have you with us. And isn't it wonderful we are able to share with the schools? It is a very, very special thing. So, just before the end of drive this morning on the Sunrise Safari, there were monkeys alarm calling in this area, and it wasn't at the lions. So I couldn't find any leopard tracks, so I'm coming to check if maybe that leopard has popped out somewhere else. Afternoon tax, just a few clubs we've been drove around. There's Birmingham, Wanuna, I've crossed south and east, and that's it.
Okay, cool, thanks, man. Yeah.
Sorry, guys, I'll be with you in a second. I haven't seen Jeromit for a few days. I did think there was some cold in maybe in Buffalo's Hook this morning.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh.
Here we go. Nice little flower. So.
Okay.
There we go. A roadside pimpernel. Now, you can get easily confused. We have another very beautiful red flower out here, which is called a lion's eye. Now, this gets even more confusing because we have another one called the lion's eye hibiscus. But the lion's eye looks very similar to this, except right in the center where that little orange dot is a bright yellow dot that resembles an eye. So there we go. This particular one is a triglycerate. And you always find them on slightly disturbed soils, so the edge of roads, fire breaks, places like that, you're likely to find that flower. Very beautiful flower. And it's amazing how the flowers have made such an explosion since the rain. What is that there? Is that an elephant dragging his foot or something else, Andre? Oh, sorry, my head's in the way. I'm trying to see it. There we go. I'm just going to move the vehicle so we can all have a look at it together. Okay, so an interesting track. I thought it might be an elephant dragging its foot or a drag mark, but there we can actually see, if we come out a bit, it is a buffalo dragging his foot. Let me just have a closer look. Sorry, I apologize. It's a giraffe, a big male giraffe who's been dragging his feet around. And you can see there, not lifting his feet. So it made those little scuff marks there. You can see the nice big giraffe hoof. Well, maybe we can catch up with him because I did drive down this road on the Sunrise Safari. So maybe we will find the giraffe who has a lazy walk. Is this incredible? Less than 2 weeks ago, we were seeing European swallows here at Juma. And Joan in England said, the first European swallow was seen on the south coast of England today. The migrants are coming back. Isn't that amazing? So less than 2 weeks ago, we were seeing them here. We've still got a few of our migrants. There's still some woodlands, kingfishers about. The European bee eaters, probably, if they haven't all left already, they're about to. I don't see the kingfishers staying too much longer either. But isn't that incredible how that same bird you could have seen on a live safari is now in England? I'm hoping we are going to find a leopard this evening. We are going to be checking very carefully. I'm pretty confident there is one on the property, but whether it is able to evade us or not, we shall find out. They have been doing a good job at evading, although we were lucky enough to spend some time with Mvula on last night's sunset safari. Debbie would like to know, are there any ripe fruits around at the moment? Debbie, there were a few ripe guarries about a week or two ago, but I haven't seen any yet. I will keep my eye open, and if they are edible, I'll definitely take advantage of having a snack while on safari. And after that cold, drizzly morning that we started off with, it has turned into a beautiful, sunshiny, sunset safari. But hopefully, we are going to be able to put some animals in this beautiful light. So Will would like to know a little bit about my favorite animal, the African wild dog. He'd like to know, when is their denning season? Well, right now is mating season if you're a wild dog, and denning season will normally start in May. Middle to late May, but they will start mating and searching for potential den sites already at this very moment. So if we do catch up with the wild dogs, which I'm very much hoping we do, let's cross fingers that they den either on or close to Juma, because when they do den, they are very locally based for about 3 months, so it gives amazing opportunity to actually see them. What was that there, Jean-Ray? Can you have a look for me? Oh, no, track, sorry. No, nothing there. Honey badger, maybe. Let's have a quick look. I think it's been driven over. So there's very different viewing wild dogs in a den than it is to viewing leopard cubs in a den, for example. So wild dogs, we'll view them very similarly to view hyenas. So we will look at them from when they are very, very small. And wild dogs will almost always, I say almost always, there's always exceptions to the rule, leave a babysitter with the den in the early, when the pups are still very young. It'll be the mom, and a little bit later, it'll be one of the last litter or the litter before. So there will always be a minder, and a very alert minder to make sure that those pups are safe. But wild dog dens are open from as soon as you find them. And it is always one of the most exciting things to be there, to see the first tiny little pup poke his nose out of the den. And I've been lucky enough to experience that a few times, and I would love to be able to share it with all of you. An oriole calling in the little stream bed to our right. bouncy, bouncy. So while we are still in search of an animal to put in this glorious afternoon light, let's jump on board with Jamie, who has found one.
Now, hopefully this beautiful antelope decides to stick around. It's a female kudu and her new calf. And it's just been so fascinating to me to watch how fast these kudu calves have grown up since we first started seeing them all wobbly and new just a couple of weeks ago, already stable on their feet, a little bit more nervous than mom. And I think it's going to keep running. Kudu do this. They would far prefer to be in the thick vegetation. There's mom there. See if the youngster won't move out into a clearer spot. This is one thing about this rainfall and the way that the vegetation has thickened out. Not that we're not incredibly grateful for it. The one just keeps moving away from me. But it is astounding how our visibility has decreased since the start of the rain. Oh, goodness, I mean, I could just see the tips of that little one's ears. They're walking behind to join Mom. Ears almost the size of an adult kudu. There's a young male as well that I didn't see before. Nope, that's not Mom, little one. That's definitely not Mom. Although it could, in theory, be Mom's previous male calf. I don't think so, though. I think it's just a young male that happened to join up with the rest, with this kudu mom and her calf. I know Brent always says that the more you look for kudu, the more you'll find them. When you stop for one, you'll suddenly find several more hiding in the trees. They don't have set herd structures, so unlike something like a zebra, so a zebra stallion collecting his harem that he will keep for the rest of his life. Kudu form little herds and then they move off on their own for a bit and then they reform little herds. They don't really have a really set breeding time either. Unlike something like an impala, which you get very specific changes in herd patterns. Although there is a definite peak of kudu births at around this time of year. Unfortunately, I think that they have moved off almost completely. I can see one watching us through the trees, but that is as good as our view will get, I think. Nevertheless, nice to see some of the youngsters that have made it through the initial risky first few weeks when mortality for young antelope is at its highest. Now, Viam and myself are on our way to follow up on where Mvula was last night. He was seen by Brent crossing into Torchwood and actually hunting buffalo, which is a fascinating thing to see. We so often talk about the fact that males or male leopards would be capable of hunting and stalking a tiny buffalo calf, but as far as I know, this is one of the first times that we've seen it in practice. Wayne, you were wondering whether or not we can give you an update as to whether or not he caught that buffalo calf or a buffalo calf. And no, Wayne, unfortunately we don't have an update other than the fact that he moved to the north. Just turn this down slightly. I can see where the buffalo herd has moved north from. These tracks are clearly from, or the tracks that I'm looking at in the road are from yesterday. And I don't know, Wayne, if he did manage or if he didn't. He wasn't seen or wasn't located this morning, and the guys didn't see his tracks either crossing back south. But you never know, and I just want to check out our northern boundary very carefully and then maybe even move towards Biffle's Hook Dam in the hope that he might have decided to start moving east from there. That's been his general pattern of movement when I first started working here. But things have changed so much with the male leopard dynamics in this particular region, due in fact to Anderson, apparently one of the biggest male leopards that's ever been seen in the Sabi Sands, pushing further and further into Tingana's territory, and Tingana responding by pushing Mvula further to the east. His movements have become somewhat unpredictable. Nevertheless, it was wonderful to see him yesterday. He is an extraordinarily beautiful leopard. A bit tatty now around the edges, scrapped ears, but he does have the most incredibly colored eyes. A pale blue color that I don't think I've ever seen on a leopard before. I'm glad that you have been enjoying our safaris. Catherine is saying that it is such a privilege to be able to go out on safari twice a day, every day, and see leopards and lions and elephants, and that she's incredibly grateful for this opportunity. Catherine, I'm with you on that. I'm incredibly grateful that I have the opportunity to conduct such safaris, and in fact, to live in and work in a place where, and I think it is a rare thing, but to be able to do a job that you never wake up in the morning and think, oh, I've got to go into work and I'm going to do the same thing over and over. That's something that I've never experienced in working out here. Every day is different. Every day comes with its surprises. Sometimes it will be a quiet day. Sometimes all of the action will happen at once. But Catherine, I'm with you. We are so lucky to be able to do what we do. And I'm so glad that we have this ability to take safaris across the globe. Well, the one thing is that there's lots and lots of water around, lots of groundwater around at the moment. The animals aren't having to move between few and far dams. They can stop off at a level and have a quick drink. This is very close to a dam that is just to on the northern side of our boundary. Even there, there's puddles in the dirt. So lots of fresh water around. Now, from what I understand, that Mvula was seen just in this area. Now, of course, the chances of him being in exactly the same place are pretty much next to nothing. But it is a good place to start in order to try and see if we can't figure out where his tracks have gone. Already, this puddle where I stopped to look for frogs the other night is slowly depleting. And in fact, the grass has essentially, since Vim and myself stopped here to listen to frogs, that was probably about a week ago, and the grass has quadrupled in size. It is something so wonderful to see. All of the grass. I mentioned it earlier during our school drive. To see the elephants munching on grass again is also such a wonderful thing. Now I'm going to take a shot in the dark and guess that Vula decided to go east from here and not further into Buffalo's Hook. And I think that will be our plan for the afternoon, to go and check and see if we don't find his tracks popping out somewhere here. Also, I owe everybody an apology, sort of an apology. I mean, you can never predict exactly what's going to happen out here, and I don't pretend to be able to. But so much for my theory that the Birmingham boys were going to be lying up at Twin Dams for the rest of the day. I can't believe they decided to up and move. There's a little dwarf-tailed mongoose, but it's being very shy. It was beautifully out in the open when I stopped, and as soon as I stopped, it decided to keep running. But there, if we look at up in the top of the dead tree, that is a very common sight to see at a dwarf mongoose sighting. A yellow-billed hornbill that is foraging alongside them. Oh, and in fact, I'm looking up in the tree, but there was one even closer. It's now flown away. That seems to be the pattern of the day, is every time I point to a bird, it flies away. Or if I point to a small animal, it decides to run away. It's just one of those things. But dwarf mongoose and yellow-billed hornbills do have that very tight relation or symbiotic relationship, and it's a mutualistic relationship between the two. The hornbills provide an extra pair of eyes up high, so they're more likely to spot a threat faster than the mongoose. And in return, they pick up the scraps of whatever the mongoose are foraging for and happen to leave behind. Mongoose are quite messy eaters. They kind of shovel everything into their face and chew it as quickly as possible. And very often that leaves little bits that are perfect hornbill-sized, bite-sized snacks. Something like the equivalent of eating insect-themed popcorn. But the dwarf mongoose just don't want to come out today. Fair enough. A little bit nervous. The weather has had a lot of the animals on edge. And some dwarf mongoose colonies are just more relaxed than others. But that relationship between the hornbills and the dwarf mongoose is very well studied. And in certain places, there's evidence that if the mongoose is late in waking up one morning, and the hornbills come to the den site and find that they haven't emerged. Oh, never mind, sorry. I'm looking at what I thought at first was a drag mark. It's most definitely not. It is a vehicle mark. You can see on my right-hand side, this is where one of the graders has turned around. I got really excited for a moment. I was thinking about Mvula and a giant kill. I think that might have been a little bit optimistic. Nevertheless, talking about dwarf mongoose, hornbills will actually go and call at the entrance to a dwarf mongoose burrow in order to wake them up. And sometimes scientists have observed mongoose, if they wake up and the hornbills are not there, will actually delay leaving the burrow to go out foraging. So just a very interesting, very close mutualistic or example of mutualism in nature. I wonder how Brent's search is going. Let's find out what he's up to. I'm going to continue on my search towards a Buffle's Hook. Enjoy your time with Brent.
So, so far
no luck. I just got an update from Steph, though, that their monkeys are alarm calling very close to the camp. So I'm just going to see if Jamie's a bit closer.
Go ahead, Brent.
Jamie, what's your position? Copy. Steph's got audio of Nkau coloring. He says around Gallagher shortcut, close to camp. If you're much closer, I don't know if you want to go have a look.
Copy. I'll go there.
Steph is following up on foot in the area. Okay, so Jamie's much, much closer, so I'm not going to speed off there. Steph's gone for a walk. He heard the monkey's alarm calling, and he's headed off to go see if he can find what they're shouting at. So I've heard a report of a big herd of buffalo that might be crossing into Juma, so we're going to slowly make our way towards that area. Who knows? Maybe Mvula is still trying to catch a baby buffalo. I know you've just seen a female kudu with Jamie. Oh, and off she goes. Bye-bye, kudu. Let's go look for the buffalo. So Thomas is wondering, are there any reptiles here? And have I ever seen a black mamba? Thomas, we've actually seen them on the live drives quite a few times. Jamie and myself have both had really spectacular sightings of black mambas close to 3 meters in length, and who knows, maybe we'll find another one today. But there are lots of different types of reptiles, lots of geckos, skinks, plated lizards, lots of different snakes, legless skinks, burrowing snakes, blind snakes, cobras, mambas, boomslangs, vine snakes, puff adders, night adders. So lots of different reptiles. They are quite difficult to see when you're not walking, and they are most of the time far more scared of you than you are of them, so they disappear before you can actually spot them when you're on the vehicle. But there are plenty, and I will keep my eye out for some reptiles for you. Thomas? Ravi in New York would like to know what species of biting and stinging ants are native to this area. Oof, lots, Ravi. I think the most common biting ant would probably be a thing called a bulbator ant, a ball biter ant, literally translated from Afrikaans. And they've got massive mandibles, incredibly powerful jaws. Also the Matabele ant, they can bite very painfully as well. But in terms of stinging ants, we don't actually have too many stinging ants in this area. They seem to be far more in the forested areas, the cocktail ants, and they can spray a little bit of acid on you. But we don't have too many stinging ants here. The worst stinging ant is it's called a velvet ant, but it's not even an ant. It's a flightless, what?
Just on the southern side of the power lines, close to you,
Sorry, just listening to an update. So, and as I was saying, the most common stinging ant is called a velvet ant, but it's not an ant, it's a flightless wasp. Well, to be correct, only the female's flightless. They're actually quite pretty, you've got little yellow spots on there. I think Jamie's got the insect book, so we can ask her to show you a picture of a velvet ant or a velvet wasp. And one of the funny things about them is that when the males who have wings come to mate with the females, they'll literally swoop from above, pick them up, mate with them while in the air, and then when they're done, just drop them and carry off on their way. So a very interesting breeding strategy, and quite unusual in wasps that only one of the sex, one of the sexes has wings. So we are going to be going a little bit quicker. We will. Jamie's gonna go see what Steph's looking at and what those monkeys alarm calling. We're probably gonna make our way in that area to give her a hand as well, unless we bump into something absolutely spectacular on the way. Secunda is wondering what is the most scarce animal in the Kruger Park. Well, Sean, I suppose it all depends on what area of the Kruger you're looking at. I would say in this area, it's probably the Art Wolf, which is a member of the Hyena Day family, but it is looks very similar to a striped hyena, but it only eats termites. They're very, very scarce. Then, of course, your normal scarcities. Pangolin, aardvark, caracal is also quite a scarce one. I'd say serval a bit more common than the others. And definitely from the bird front, there's some incredibly scarce species. One of the only places you can find racket-tailed rollers is in northern Kruger in Pafuri. And they've got some incredible birding up there. But it all depends on the different area of the park you're in. And each area will have its own sort of regional scarcities that might be more common in another area of the park, depending on soil types, grass types, rock types, etc. Lots of spider webs today. just keeps blowing out of my... There we go. Just sort of the light catching it in front of me there. Slightly irritating. So I'm trying to see where this buffalo herd is. Deborah, the armchair traveller, would like to know if we had white-fronted bee eater or what is that? So I just want to make sure it's not the naughty elephant before we approach closer. There's a herd here as well. So quickly across to Jamie, she's got something.
Now we've been racing across in the direction of alarm calls that Steph has heard. But we've just stumbled upon the most beautiful view and also an interaction between this young elephant bull and the buffalo that is attempting to get away from him. And this bull just harassing the buffalo and chasing him in Vuyatela Dam. Shame, and all the poor buffalo wants to do is move away. This is just such a stunning sighting that we had to stop our mad race across to follow up on those alarm calls. Luckily, Steph is out on foot. He's trying to follow up for us. So hopefully he will be able to update his monkey's alarm calling. Look at this elephant splashing the buffalo. An elephant scattered all around the pan and the open area around Vuyatela Dam. This is too stunning to pass up. Buffalo and the elephant reaching the conclusion, I think for now, of their disagreement over water space. Little bull has decided to stop and feed. Okay, we're going to race off across in the direction of those alarm calls. In the meantime, I'm going to send you back over to Brent and hopefully we'll be back with you shortly.
So, and that's elephants we saw, unfortunately, rushed off into the thicket. And we're now at a traffic jam. I'm not sure what for. Let's see. How's Mikey? What you got there? Sorry? Ah, my ticket talk. Okay, well, we're going to follow up on some monkey alarm calls. So, oh, look, there's a baby. Very young little dwarf mongoose. Hello. Very cute little guys. Definitely one of my favorites. And you might have heard me use the word matsikitsoch. That is the Shanghai name for the dwarf mongoose. Now, these guys will pop down the hole and we're on a... gonna keep heading towards where those alarm calls are. Oh, excuse me. I think I scared all the poor dwarf mongoose with that sneeze. Cheers, cheers. So, let's rush off. Hopefully there's a leopard there. And I know Jamie's there, Steph's there, but let's, because we didn't find any leopard this morning, and we put two vehicles into that area trying to find what's there, we double our chances. Check carefully, you never know. So while we're making our way towards those alarm calls, let's see how clever you guys are. We're talking about scarce species. Now, I'm going to take it a little bit broader. I've asked you how many spiral horned antelope or truffle legged there are in Africa before. But now I'm going to ask you, how many members of the Hyena Day family? So how many animals are there in the Hyena family, the super or the order Hyena Day? If you know, can you name them? So what? Now, how many and what are the names of the members of the Hyena Day family? If you know the answer, send me an email on questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Sorry guys, just gotta listen to the radio.
I haven't updated any Nyari, but I have just driven past some.
Okay, so sorry, we might lose you as we go through this little dip. Sometimes this is a bad signal spot. Okay, I just heard something might have scared a bunch of elephants at the Juma Dam cam, so let's go have a look. Is he gonna fly away? If we can get him, it could be a good one. As he scuttled. I didn't see him fly out. He might be just hiding in the thicket here. There was a little black-crowned chagra. And he is smart, smarter than me. And made his disappearance. Off he goes. So we'll go see what scared those ellies.
In the next sort of 15 minutes or so, maybe half an hour.
I wonder what those monkeys are alarm calling at. I have this insatiable curiosity to know what predator has been spotted. Hopefully Jamie finds out what it is. And maybe it's the queen who has been giving us the most absolute run around. Tracks here, tracks there, but no Queen Karula. At the Juma Dam cam. I wonder what spooked those ellies. Could it be a tech team member trying to fix things? But we'll have a look now. We should be there shortly. I think it's more than likely they could be being chased by a musk bull. Can be,
just south of Milberry. There's in Gonzi. It looks like must be Jimmy from the Tempe. This morning.
Well, there's an update on the wild dogs. The tracks were found quite far to the east of us, and they have gone into the Kruger National Park. So. Oh, elephants everywhere today. So well done to James Lee Pad and Maggie M. who have got the answers to that Hyena Day quiz spot on. It is striped hyena, brown hyena, spotted hyena, and of course the art wolf who we were talking about. And we're here with the Stumpy Trunk family, and there's the little boy. Hello, mister. And there's the female. So this is a nice little herd of elephants we do see quite regularly. Hello, guys. Always amazes me how the adult female there, look how she's even able to pick grass with that shortened trunk. Sorry guys, I've just heard something on the radio.
We did find a dead python, perhaps just feeding on that, I'm not sure. Dixon, come back to yours.
There we go.
Yeah, go yours.
Dixon,
Elise. Then I went, there was some small slump involved, and now the slump is there.
So they are moving on quite a mission, so if they move off into the bush, we're not going to follow them off-road. There we go, and we're going to have a look at... You can see her trunk when we get a little bit closer. You can see her... Her trunk there, she obviously picked up that injury a long time ago and it's healed, but she's had to learn to do without that very dexterous little twin. And it is amazing how she has adapted, and she's got a young baby at the moment who's very healthy. Now, Tom in Dallas is wondering, could a young elephant who gets a fright spark a charge from a whole herd? Most definitely, it can happen, but fortunately, it doesn't happen too often. So, sorry guys, I'm just listening to the radio. Okay, I was just getting an update there from Steph, who's out on foot. And look at this, isn't it absolutely splendid? Oh, itchy ear. It looks like they're gonna head off into those thickets. We'll try and get a few more glimpses of them. Donna in California is wondering, do females stop having babies as they get older, and if at what age? Donna, they'll probably stop having babies once they get to around 50 years old. So yes, they do. You can see, not the best spot to see them. Lots of ellies around at the moment. And see, just see the trees being plucked apart. So let's leave these ellies and see what else we can find. There you are, coming out into the open. Well, let's stay a little bit longer then. Well, open being a strong word, but maybe just coming into a little window. Sandra on YouTube is wondering, do elephants use a suction at all to pick up the grass? No, Sandra, they've got a prehensile tip to their trunk, and they're also their trunk is made up of many thousands of muscles, and they will literally use that prehensile tip to grab and then twist and turn to place it in their mouth the same way as they as that one's doing to the branch there. There we go. You can see how the trunk is curled, and that little tip is actually a prehensile. So you imagine, there we go, you can actually see it there, slightly tip, curl, and then pop in the mouth. So basically they've got a little hand at the end of their trunk that enables them to grip small things. Robin in Maryland is wondering, do elephants learn to use their trunk by watching other elephants, or is it instinctual? I'd say it's mostly instinctual. When the young guys are born, they're actually not very good at losing their trunk, and they actually have to teach themselves almost by just playing with their trunk. There might be a very little bit of learning from watching others, but I don't think so. I think they just eventually will figure it out for themselves. Same as you don't have to teach an animal to walk. Hungry elephant. So a big elephant bull eats over 400 pounds of vegetable matter in a day. Little one like this probably does close on 200 pounds, and elephants will feed throughout the day and night. They will take little respites throughout that period, but they are constantly eating. They don't have the best digestive system, only extracting about 60 to 70% of the potential nutrients in their food, and passing out a lot of nutrients. But in doing so, their dung is very important to a lot of other animals who will feed out of it, and also very important for seeds to germinate from. Moving on to the grass, having turf and aerial meal today. So from the ground to the leaves, getting the best of both worlds after the rain. Kai, who's watching on YouTube, is wondering, what happens to the thorns? Well, Kai, like a little branch, they'll go through to the stomach. Some of it will be digested if it's small enough. If not, it'll just be passed out. So, guys, I've got a hunch about where we should go check next. So as soon as these eddies move off, I'm going to do the same. This little one is having a serious feast, though. So this one's probably around 10, 11 years old, a young female.
Okay.
There we go. We saw exactly there how an elephant picks grass. So there we go. As that little eddy disappears into the bush, we're going to head up towards the western corner of Juma and see what's happening in that area. Okay, so beautiful light. Now let's find something to pop in it. Jean-Ray, what would you like?
Leopard.
Leopard. Okay, let's go look for a leopard. I'm feeling lucky. Jean-Ray and I have had some decent leopard luck in the last 24 hours with Mvula popping up in front of us yesterday while we were with that buffalo herd. So I'm going to go check that area just in case he has meandered back to the south from Buffalo's Hook. So let's see if there are any tracks in that area where we had Mvula yesterday. A nice comfortable temperature at the moment, not too hot, not too cold. Sometimes quite nice to just drive and enjoy the light. I just noted how amazingly fast the bush has grown since the rain. A week or two ago, we had ellies in full view for long distances, but now the leaves have just exploded and the elephants are able to disappear quite quickly into some of these thickets, which were not so thick 3 weeks ago. So while we go in search of a spotted, actually correct terminology, a rosetted cat, I think we should put you guys on the test again. And who can tell me how many different species of cat could potentially occur on Juma? How many different species of cat? So big cat, small cat, and what are their names? Jean-Ré thinks he's seen something. So let's just have a look what we got here. What tracks did you see, Jean-Ré? Well, spotted hyena tracks. So we are on the search for leopard tracks, but there we go, those are hyena tracks. So while we continue to look for a leopard track, let's go have a look what Jamie's got.
Well, we have raced off in the direction of the alarm calls. That is where the monkeys were calling from, looking across in this direction. And we have a kill, and we have a very unusual kill that Steph has actually found for us. And it is, you'll see in a moment why it is such an unusual kill. Just look at that. Look at what we found here. It's a dead python. Now, we don't know if there was something feeding on it, and that was what the monkeys were alarm calling at. We're following the smell to search for whatever it was that was causing them alarm. It is not impossible that a leopard killed this python. Leopards are known to do that, but it's quite mangled. It's almost rotten. I'm going to get out. Definitely not going to be touching it. It is so smelly. But I'll get out just to give you a bit of a closer look at it. Such an interesting find. That was not what I was expecting Steph to report back to us at all when he heard those alarm calls. Now, he says he's checked all around. He hasn't found any tracks yet. But that doesn't mean that there aren't any. That is fairly rank in terms of smell. This is not a fresh kill. The flies or the maggots are already about this big. So about the size of my thumbnail in here. So I'm not sure what happened to this python. Whoa. Even for my strong stomach, this is fairly gross. I'm trying to see if I can find you the head. It has definitely been fed on, but to be completely honest, it looks more like it's been fed on by a bird of prey rather than a leopard or something similar. What a mystery we have here. I'm not normally squeamish, but this is really gross. Oh, large carcass flies all over the show. I can see the rib bones. Unfortunately, I can't get the car in close enough to show you properly. Ah, it's so squishy. If you're sensitive, don't look. So quite a large African rock python. Such a shame. We don't see them all that often. I'm just going to put that down. I'm going to leave that stick and I'm going to move back to the car. Ooh, okay. Regain control over my stomach. Make my way back here. I don't know that we've got much more that we can learn by investigating any closer. It's sort of turned into rather soupy-like substance within it, so I'm not going to be able to lift it up and examine it closely without it all falling out in a soup-like mix. Let me just plug myself back in. Hold on a sec, my earpiece hole has disappeared. There we go. Whew. Okay, how's your stomach feeling, Liam? He's okay. Yeah, no, he's fine. Just me. So, a mystery for us to solve. We found a kill. The question is, what killed that python? I have no idea. Maybe it was killed by another python. I think that's fairly unusual, though. And for a large, I mean, that python is about, when not rotten and slightly squishy, about that size. That would be about the diameter of that python at its thickest point. And close to, well over 6 feet long. An interesting, very interesting mystery for us to solve. Now, although it is smelly and quite decomposed, it is not beyond the realms of what a leopard might consider eating. I think, let us go and see if we can't figure out what those monkeys were alarm calling at and whether or not we can find any tracks. Oh, goodbye, python. I'm assuming Steph found it through scent. There you can actually, from this angle now, You can see the scales of the underbelly. And the skin. And those flies with the large red eyes are large carcass flies. So interesting to see them settling on a python like this. I'm not sure whether or not you guys heard the alarm calls coming from the house behind us. Those were alarm calls of a small child, not alarm calls from a monkey or anything like that. Just hear. I could just hear Mike shouting instructions. It's very funny. Their kids are so well behaved. We live next door to them and they really have the most wonderful children. There is a bird of prey sitting up in one of these trees, I noticed. That would also be a likely suspect for whatever's been munching on our snake. I don't know where it's gone now. In fact, I've lost it completely. I think it has flown off probably when I got up and started investigating that kill. Peggy has said this is the one time that she's so glad smell-o-vision doesn't exist. Absolutely, Peggy. I think that out here, if smell-o-vision were ever to become a thing or a possibility technological-wise, and to provide an all immersive experience, I think that perhaps for this show, we might have to be a little bit selective as to when we turned it on and off. I don't think any of you would appreciate sitting in downwind of a rotting buffalo, or in fact lion flatulence or anything similar along those lines. Now that python is not the smelliest thing I've ever smelt in the world. I've smelt worse. It was just the liquefaction that really got me. And I'm usually very strong-stomached with this sort of thing. Nevertheless, absolutely fascinating. One of those mysteries that I wish we could just go back in time and know the answer to. And unfortunately, well, I suppose that is what makes life out here fun, is that you can't have the answer to every question that you could ask. Oh, I made the same mistake as Jean-Ray there, pulling over for hyena tracks. Now, let us see if the monkeys were alarm calling at something feeding on that, or whether or not they were trying to alert everything else to the presence of something else. And check really carefully all along the power lines road. Steph saw them round about where we are now. He said it was difficult to gauge exactly what they were looking at. Oh no, this isn't the road I want to be on, sorry. I've already checked this road in my mad race to get here. Whew. Just going to have a sip of water. Try and rid myself of the aftertaste of that scent. Cool. Quick gulp of water and on with our search. We started off our afternoon after the elephants looking for a leopard anyway, looking for a mvula. Generally when monkeys alarm call, there's a couple of different animals that they will call for. They'll call for a large eagle, they will call for lions, they will alarm call for snakes, and they will alarm call for leopards and lions. And master trackers like Renius would probably be able to tell you exactly which alarm or which call they're making for what animal. For us, I don't think any of us have quite got to the point where we can differentiate as clearly. But as soon as the monkeys start going, they're trying to tell us something, and they've got the most extraordinary eyesight. And that coupled with the fact that they sit up high means that they are far more likely to spot a potential threat. So keep your eyes peeled. Steph said after he saw them, they started running a bit further to the south of where we are, which suggests to me that whatever the threat was, they certainly wouldn't be running towards it. So that makes more sense that it's on the north of us. Only thing is that it does mean we have to drive straight into the sun to figure this out. I'm going to concentrate on tracking and checking around this area very, very carefully. While I do that, let's get an update from Brent.
So I've come to the opposite side. So those monkeys were alarm calling down there. I'm just coming to check in case that whatever they were alarming is hasn't come this way. And I did see some leopard tracks, but I've got a sneaky suspicion. I'm going to go have another look at them. I just had a quick glance as we went past that those could be Mvula's tracks from yesterday. And then we'll go, I'll show you them in about 5 seconds. So, there we go, look at that. I just want to have a quick look, see if there's not another set of tracks. They could look more fresh than they are because I just want to see that drizzle would have left a slight remnant over them. But this is exactly where Aubrey called in tracks yesterday. So I just want to check with the road. Maybe there's more than one set of tracks. I'm going to have a closer look at these ones that are so beautifully clear here. I'm trying to remember when they dragged this road. See, when you get down and have a little bit closer of a look, you can actually see the little marks from the rain. So these tracks are from yesterday, not from today. But they are so beautiful and clear. And that's such a pity. But this is a... We found Mvula just beyond here yesterday when we were looking for him. We're actually on our way to follow up on these tracks. Well, very well done to Lee Pad, who got that how many cat species in the Kruger question correct. There are 6 indigenous species, but if you want to be a stickler for detail, there are actually 7, but I'll go through them now. Sorry, I've just spotted another track I want to have a look at. That's all hyena tracks here. Okay, so the species of cat that occur in the Kruger is the, of course, the obvious big ones, which are lion, leopard, and cheetah. And then the smaller cats, we have serval, caracal, and the last one is an African wild cat. But if you want to be a real stickler for the facts, unfortunately, especially on the edge of Kruger, where it is close to local communities, you can add a 7 species, Felis domestus, the domestic house cat. So that's 6 indigenous wild species and the occasional feral cat. Now, those feral cats are actually a very big problem. And if they are found in any of the reserves, they are destroyed on site. They can put diseases into the wild populations, and also with African wildcats, they interbreed with them and it affects the genetics of those wild cats. Quite often those feral cats are very, very inbred and not very well looked after, so they've got lots of nasties in their systems. Checking so carefully. Yeah, it's a hyena again. Yep. And it's amazing, with this rain, finding some of these cats, particularly things like leopards, has become that much more challenging. Your visibility from the road has been cut down immensely. Oh, did you spot that, Chandra? You're not gonna see them too much from going forward. Oh no, he's gonna disappear. There was a little woodlands kingfisher, but there he took off. They're gonna be departing for warmer climbs, heading up back to Central and West Africa. While we continue to check through here, Jamie has got a piggy to show you.
I did have a piggy to show you. Unfortunately, as is par for the course, over the last sort of two drives, my pig is now gone. There he is, right at the back there. He's about to disappear. It is a very large male. You can see the protrusions on the side of his face. Exceptionally sort of exposed, and that's very common with the males. The warts that give warthogs their names, not actually warts, but pieces of connective tissue and grizzly cartilage that provide and protect their eyes. In males, they have four of those, and they are more enlarged. Oh, interesting. Female coming running in. They're more enlarged in males because they have a protective function. She positively gallops towards this handsome gentleman. Oh, around the bushes she goes. Is she going to come out to the right? Yeah, she's coming. Is she racing to this male? Or is she racing for another reason? I can't quite decide. I mean, I think he's pretty attractive in warthog standards, whatever warthog standards might be. No. Oh, that's a bit disappointing. I was hoping she was going to go running to greet him. Forward a little bit further. No, he's going to disappear, unfortunately. There's also another animal hiding, and it just goes to show what kind of, or how different it is walking during a wet and rainy summer as opposed to a winter or in the drought-like conditions we've been experiencing. First of all, there's muddy pans everywhere. Second of all, there are buffalo bulls everywhere, and they're not nearly as visible as they were when the vegetation was slightly browner and less dense and thick. Can you believe that there's a buffalo hiding there? We are not more than 30 meters away, so not really more than 90 odd feet. And he's almost completely invisible to us, particularly when facing directly into the sun. So an important thing to remember when walking about in the bush during this time of year, that, and that's one of the reasons why it's nice to know the positions of all the different pans in an area, so that you don't find yourself stumbling into a buffalo like that. I'm still on my search for whatever it was that caused the monkeys such distress. So far, no tracks to report. There's also a couple, there were a couple of kudu moving about close to where the monkeys were. And as far as, from what Steph told me, he didn't hear any other alarm calls other than the monkeys. Kudu, of course, having that deep booming bark that is low in pitch in order to move through, being able to move through dense vegetation and carry the sound further. So whatever it was that the monkey spotted, the kudu did not. That's a really interesting little piece of information from Anne, who is watching in Texas but has been to visit Barbados, where she encountered the green monkeys, I believe is what they're called, in that part of the world. Barbados, of course, being exceptionally far away from where we are now. Sorry, there's a thorn in my blankets that I sit on to buffer up my seat. Very tiny one. But Anne's, the suggestion with the green monkeys, the Barbados green monkeys, is that they look really similar to vervet monkeys that we get here, and in fact sound very similar as well. She was saying, as far as she knows, Barbados is one of the only islands where the type of monkey is found, and it would be interesting to know exactly how such similar monkeys came to be in such diverse systems. And that's a really, really interesting point, and it's a really one of those questions that does vex the average evolutionary biologist. It's known as convergent evolution, so where evolution has favored very similar traits in animals far away from each other, separate from each other. I don't know the exact point at which vervet monkeys evolved and whether or not there was some kind of connection still between the land masses. I doubt it. As far as I know, Pangaea and Gondwana had split long before the monkeys started evolving on the different continents. But that is really interesting. The fact that they traveled, maybe there must be some, I would assume there is some kind of link, or maybe it's just a habitat that has favored a very, very similar design in those two monkey species. Imagine how on earth we got, or how a monkey that looks nearly identical to our vervet monkeys wound up in the Caribbean, miles and miles, thousands of miles away from where we are now. That's fascinating, and I really am very grateful for that information. I'm going to be doing some looking up or researching on them. Here we go. Okay, we have an answer. So the reason that the monkeys look so similar is apparently, this is the information that's coming through to me, is apparently because they were introduced there from South Africa and neighboring countries. The slavers brought them as pets. Why didn't I think of that? That makes total sense now. Total, complete and utter sense. So the reason that they are so similar looking is because they're the same species, essentially. They're probably just adapted and become localized and, what's the word? It's a feral population, basically, that has gone wild once again. And just on the subject of having monkeys as pets, most of you will know that it is quite an ill-advised venture. We've spoken a lot about our personal opinions on having wild animals as pets, but monkeys in particular can become exceptionally aggressive, particularly once they're very cute as the babies, but once they reach sexual maturity, they become protective over one member of the family, and they bond with one person or maybe a couple of people, and then become very territorial and very defensive around that person. So if you ever did find yourself in possession of a monkey, you better hope that you never want to have guests around to your house or anything like that. But as I said, definitely not, or as I have spoken about before, definitely not fair on the animal itself. But there we go, we have an answer. Well, very well observed that Anne managed to match up or see the similarities between the species. Nevertheless, we have an explanation, and it is just that they are exactly the same. We still have our mysterious python death to investigate. And MJ, yes, we do have secretary birds can occur in the Juma area. We're less likely to see them here than we would be on, for example, the open area of the Arethusa airstrip, which, as far as I know, is the only place that they have been seen on the live drives. And they're also more towards the eastern boundaries of Torchwood and Cheetah Plains, where they are seen on a fairly regular basis. They like the nice open grasslands in terms of hunting snakes, but you are right, a secretary bird could have been responsible for the death of that python. What surprised me about it was just the size, the sheer size of that python. Whilst I think that a secretary bird would be capable of it, it might be something that the secretary bird would think twice about tackling. Now, although pythons are not venomous, the African rock python is not a venomous snake, it does have a number of fixed teeth within its mouth and can inflict very painful bites. It's also an incredibly powerful animal. And it's a shame, I must say, it is a shame to see one that large dead. They are fairly unusual. It's fairly unusual to see one that has managed to reach that size over the number of years that it takes for them to grow to that kind of length and thickness. Now, there are lots of stories about, because just like elephants, pythons grow throughout their lives. And there are lots of stories about pythons that are 6 feet on or longer. Sorry, not 6 feet, 6 meters or longer. So over 18 feet. And those are starting now to be discounted, because whilst there are some very, very large pythons, once they reach a certain age and a certain length, sort of around 2.5 meters long, they no longer grow so much in length, and it's more that they expand more and more around the waist of their bodies. So a really, really large python could weigh well over 100 kilograms, 200 pounds, and be easily this thick. They can, it's the largest snake we get here. They can reach massive sizes, but they don't often manage it, which is why it's actually quite sad to see a young dead python. Now, I actually didn't mean to come and stop at the hyena den, but I'm pulling in and the hyena cubs are out and the horse is just leaving. It might be worth doing a quick stop off just to see. I wasn't planning on coming here. I was just trying to follow up on where I thought those alarm calls might have been coming from. Lots of nice vocalization though. Copy that, thanks. I'm just going to bypass here. Oh, look at this. We can't really leave now, can we? Not when they're being this entertaining. Can you hear the squealing? That is a very specific sound, and it's known as squeeing, and it's a begging sound from the cub. We had the most extraordinary sighting yesterday with the matriarch disciplining her two cubs that were being wayward and naughty and moving too far from the den site. Look how brave these cubs are getting. Right out, coming right out towards the main road. Here we go, look at it. It's going to come and investigate right up close. Now, we spoke at length yesterday about why it is that These little cubs are so much braver at a much younger age. And we spoke about how the influence of older cousins has played a large role in getting them to move further from the den, younger than they might normally have. Hello. Yes, you are so cute. Hard to believe these are the same cubs that we've watched grow up. See the curiosity in them, constantly learning and experiencing. And if that older cub were to come a bit closer towards us, I think that the younger ones would be tempted into doing the same. Now that looks to me like November. Oh no, maybe it's a little bit too smaller. Something obviously smells very interesting around this road. This is an absolutely stunning sighting. Looks like at least one of the December twins at the back, maybe two. I can't quite tell. Yes, it does look like two. Moving about with Mom at the back. So it was November that had come a bit closer to us. And they've had boundless energy over the last 2 days. This is like a repeat of the scene that we witnessed yesterday afternoon. And there's nothing more entertaining than chewing on the various sticks and plants around the den site. Oh, except sometimes they fight back. Get it. Get it. Pull. You can do it. You can do it. Oh, now I want to join in. This bush looks like more fun than the one I was playing with. And also you had it, and therefore I want it. Actually, I think I might go and take that stick. They are so entertaining. This is my favorite age to observe hyena cubs. They're brave enough to start, and coordinated enough, most importantly, to start exploring their outside world properly. But at the same time, they still retain that innocence and cuteness of youth. Hello, gorgeous girl. And painted wolf, being very observant. Oh, here comes Corky, it looks like. Painted Wolf said that it looks as though the adults were anal pasting around the entrance. I'm not sure if that was Corky, actually. Mistaken identity. It looks more like Madam. Painted Wolf has said it looked like the adults were anal pasting around that area. One of the larger ones was anal pasting, and perhaps that's what the cubs were sniffing. You're absolutely right, it was one of the things they were sniffing, and in fact, a couple of the cubs actually anal pasting on top of that, or attempting to. Oh, look at all the play that's happening at the back there. Very active hyena den. Having a marvelous time. Painted Wolf, I love your username, by the way. And as the evening is starting to draw to a close, I found myself unable to resist the lure of the hyena den. So we'll go a bit closer. In the meantime, let's have a look at the stunning view that Brent has found for you.
Look at that spectacular setting African sun. You can actually see it moving. It's going to pop behind that cloud bank shortly. Look at that, isn't that special? It's always a good time to sit quietly, watch the sunset, listen for potential alarm calls.
When I'm on the
and listen to Ephraim talk lots of noise on the radio. Just turn that off quickly while we're enjoying this spectacular, peaceful view. Look at this, starting to dip below the lower cloud bank. It is not the Drakensberg, Chandra. Chandra is trying to say that is the Drakensberg. I know the shape of the Drakensberg in this part of the world quite well. So the mountain's actually lower than that, and that is a cloud. Yes. It almost seems like it's paused for a second there. Penny Pine is wondering, are there any inactive volcanoes in the park? The last time there were any active volcanoes in this part of the world, Penny, was a couple of hundred million years ago. So there are some calderas and things you can see, not on Juma, but in the Kruger itself. But this area would not have had many volcanoes. It would have been closer to the Lubombo Mountains, where the closest volcano to us would be. Anyway, as the sun disappears, we're going to, and let's go see what those wonderful little hyenas are up to.
The hyenas are having an absolute ball. Hello. Just look at them all. Oh, somebody's been very brave and coming to investigate the front of the vehicle. Yes, I see you. Oh, there's two of you there. Oh, now there's three. Oh, this is the trouble crowd. It's the December twins and June that come and nibble on the front bumper and nibble on my tires. Now I've got to try and keep an eye on them and just see whether or not they are up to no good. And if I sit still, I might even be able to, oh! Scatter, everybody scatter. One of them got a fright and they all went dashing away from the car, except for this little brave one that is more courageous than the rest. Oh, it's moments like these that make the pull of the hyena den irresistible. Yes, you little monsters. You've grown so much as well. Let's see how close this one will dare. Oh, it's gonna go right in front again. All investigating their world, chewing about, whilst watched indulgently and patiently by the various adults. It looks as if we've got all three moms here this afternoon, Pretty, Corky, and Madam. There's another adult off to the back there, which is why the cubs are feeling so comfortable about being out and about. That's Madam, I think, from what I can see, plus her tolerance of the cub that keeps climbing all over her. And I think that was June playing with them. And then I think Pretty is here in front of us, from what I can tell. And then that would make Corky at the back. Be difficult for me to see exactly from my angle, but either way, we've got all three mothers here. Oh, back onto the road. So nice to have playful company. Imagine just one lonely hyena cub being raised in a den site would be exceptionally bored, having to entertain itself. Luckily for them, they've all got company and companionship of roughly the same size, so they can play fight, build up the skills and the coordination and the strength that they will need in their adult lives. And they can afford the energy to do this. The Milky Way female hyena is one of the richest of any of the mammal species out here. and they know that they will be, particularly the high rank, the cubs of the high-ranking females, will be provided for up to a year and a half. What has that one got? A branch. Nothing like a good game of tug-of-war. I spoke about this yesterday, the fact that as soon as one gets something, the other one wants it. Doesn't matter what it is. Oh, there we go. Still in possession of it. Having to duck around the obstacle course that is home. We've spoken before about what we should nickname flat hyenas when they're out, passed out sleeping. We always talk about flat cats and log dogs. Raybo has suggested flopped spots, and the Latin version, floppicus spoticus, which definitely works and is a sort of Monty Python-esque in its own way. I'm not sure if Monty Python-esque is a word, but we'll go with it. The thing about a hyena den sighting like this is picking a position is fairly difficult because they come dashing about like, what would I call, pinballs almost. And they change and pick and choose their direction all the time, or change their direction all the time. It's amazing we don't hear, oh goodness, look at that. It's amazing that we don't hear more squeals considering how roughly they play. Most of them disappearing off from view for now. Let's just have a quick look at the antelope that Brent has found.
So the rutting season is setting in quite prominently now, and we just had a male making a huge racket and chasing some females around. Hopefully he's going to do it again shortly. And look at them all enjoying this lovely green grass. Murphy's Law, as we pop the camera on, he stops making a noise. So it looks like these impala are not playing along, and they've decided to stop chasing each other. So let's head back to those wonderful little hyenas.
The cub's still being highly entertaining, dashing about in a tumble of cubs. I don't know what we would call this. It's almost... one is almost indistinguishable from the other at this point. Look at this. Where does one start and where does the other end? Very tolerant mums keeping an eye on them. Oof. Every now and again, one individual gets particularly cornered by the rest of the group. I'm not entirely sure who's fighting whom here. I'm not even entirely sure they know. It's just one big rough and tumble game. Complete chaos. Isabella, who is one of our five-year-old viewers. Isabella, you were saying, why am I calling them monsters? Because you thought that they weren't bad like they are in The Lion King. Isabella, you are absolutely right. I'm calling them monsters playfully. That's like my... Oh, we've got some strobe lighting happening here at the hyena den. Isabella, I'm calling them monsters. It's like a nickname. It's my way of feeling affectionate or showing affection and love towards the hyena cubs. So I don't mean monsters like they're horrible, because you are right. The hyenas in The Lion King are absolutely not, hyenas in real life are not bad guys. They're not like the hyenas in The Lion King. And just looking at them playing like this, you can see how cute they really are. Amazing the sub-adult is, playing with all of the cubs at once, and basically has created a game of tag. It's like an older babysitter entertainer. Whee! Oof. I'm just exhausted looking at them, just thinking about it. And Isabella, sometimes I call them monsters because they get playful and they come and they chew on my car. But that's okay. I don't mind. Watching them gamble about, it's nearly impossible to identify one individual to the next as they run around like this. Not just that, hyenas and hyena cubs, it's very tricky for us. And you'll notice when I refer to them as the cubs by names, I generally don't refer to male or female. I don't really use he or she. And Darlene has been doing some research on hyenas and said that male bellies curve up towards the hind legs, whereas females don't. And have I ever been able to use this as a method for identifying the difference between males and females? For those of you actually watching and unfamiliar with hyenas as a species, this needs a bit of background clarification. Because with most mammals... This is such a mad race. I'm actually going to try and reposition because most of it is happening behind a tree. It seems as though, Darlene, I will be back to you with that question, but while I reposition, it seems as though Brent's impala are playing along.
So, Murphy's Law, as we cut away, that impala leapt across the screen, but it seems to be calming down a little bit. We can stay with him. Oh, wait, there we go. Here he comes. There's the male. Trying to sequester his harem before the breeding season starts in earnest. Let me just reverse back. The youngsters running for the joy. Is that him there? With his tail out? Yes, there he is. You can see he's marking all over the branches around here. This is quite a good territory if you're a male impala. You hear that? Okay, let's quickly jump. Oh, wait one second. He's going to take off. Is he going to do it for us this time? There we go. Pandemonium. Listen to him. Here he comes, chasing that female. Oh, right behind us. Nice camera, Jandre. Awesome work. Off he goes. Okay, let's pop across back to the hyenas, who are rolling in a nice pile of fresh vomit.
Well, we managed to get the impalas racing around. In the meantime, it's all go here. It seems as though vomiting in the hyena clan is very much a family affair. Madam got up to vomit, and then the rest of the cubs tried to gather to eat it and to roll in it. She wanted to eat it again. So she wasn't very happy about that. Pretty then came to investigate the scene. And all in all, a bit of chaos. Yummy. Nothing like rolling about in vomit to add to your day. I'm actually going to try and move out of your view just so you can see all of the hyenas that are moving about past us. It's exactly the same behavior they displayed with Brent a couple of days ago. Oh, so exciting. Fresh vomit for me to roll in. Now, whilst I do love hyenas, I have never claimed that they are the cleanest or the most pleasant-smelling animals. Yep. Yes. Janine, it is rather smelly over here, particularly next to the vomit. It's definitely wafting its scent across to us. So interesting how Pretty came to investigate the whole deal as well. She came right from the back to come and see what was going on. Where have all, they've all moved off in that direction. One of them still quite happily ensconced in the vomit. The rest of them in front of me here. All in all, lots and lots of hyena cub action. And you? What would you want? What do you want, little thing? So cute. Here comes sub-adult into the fray. Thinking of coming to bugger. Oh, now Pretty's gone to go and investigate the vomit. Have a jolly good sniff. Decide what she wants from it there. It's so interesting the way they all interact around that particular aspect of things. So, Darlene, we were in the middle of answering your question. You notice whenever I talk to the hyena cubs, I refer to them as you. I refer to them as very gender-neutral terms. That's because hyenas, spotted hyenas, are one of the most difficult animals to sex out here. The females have an extended clitoris that looks like that is essentially a pseudo-penis, and it's a fused tract between the reproductive vaginal tract and as well as the urethra, so the urinary tract. One of the only examples in the mammal world where this occurs. Their labia are also extended to look like false testicles. But you can see why when I talk about how difficult it is, you kind of get an idea of just how tricky it can be. So the method that Darlene has said in terms of looking at the curve of a belly is quite a useful one, but it's very difficult to see in the youngsters. Now you can also have a look at the tip of either the true penis or the pseudo penis. In males, there's a slight tightening towards the end. That being said, particularly in youngsters that have yet to have cubs, it is, to me personally, I find it difficult to say with absolute 100% certainty we have a male or a female, because I promise you I have seen cubs before that I have identified as male on the basis of the research and the pictures that provide us with that tightening of the, or the sort of the nipping of the tip towards the end, only to find 3 years later that they had cubs. So I find it personally difficult to sex them. It's generally a little bit easier in terms of judging it on their behavior. But even then, rank confuses things as well. You don't always get the complete clear picture. Nice vocalizations happening. All gone quiet now. So, but that being said, Darlene, that doesn't mean that we haven't got a very good idea of the males and the females in this clan. Obviously, we know with the mothers of the cubs what sex they are. And as the cubs have started getting a little bit older, it's become more clear whether or not they are a male. So for me, November is almost certainly a boy. But never say anything certain with spotted hyenas. They can confuse you so easily. They've moved off behind the den, and I'm actually going to take this as an opportunity to leave them. It is too dark now for us to really get a good view. And as you know, we don't put spotlights in the den. That and the fact that I actually wasn't really planning on stopping by here anyway. I just couldn't resist when following up on those alarm calls, since they were all out, right out in the middle of the road. But we'll say goodbye to our spotted hyena cubs for now, and we'll carry on with our search. Who knows? Perhaps there is a leopard wandering around Galago Pan. I think that's our next port of call. Oh, goodness, somebody got a fright. It was a cub, right? There was always one cub somewhere around here. Raced away from us. Please don't worry, I'm very careful when I go out of the hyena den. They did have a little bit of an argument over who got to roll in the vomit, roll in Madam's vomit. And James Richards was wondering, is there any purpose to that? Does it serve any function, rolling in vomit or scat, as they do seem to love to do? And James, it's something that lions do, it's something that wild dogs very regularly do, and it's something that hyenas love to do. And there's a couple of different theories about what it might be. Some people say it's to mask their natural scent, but obviously that only works if they're rolling in something other than the smell of their own species. Other people have argued that it reinforces the bonds between the members of the group, because then you take on the scent of another individual. It's up to you what you find to be the most convincing argument. I'm not 100% sure either way. Sometimes I think they just like it. I mean, scent to them is such a different thing to our sanitized world and our sanitized thoughts about what smells nice. Maybe it smells nice to them. Maybe they like that smell. You know, we've got a brain that interprets healthy smelling, sweet smelling herbs or flowers or perfumes, which, by the way, if you delve deep enough into the construction of perfume, you might not feel quite so.
The moon is that way.
The moon is that way.
Yeah.
I'm stopping for the sunrise, but Vim's not. Or sunrise? That night went very quickly. I meant sunset. But Vim is telling me we need to go and observe the moonrise, and he is absolutely right. For today, it is full moon. Let us go and see if we can get a nice view of the moon peeking over the horizon. So funny. Vim just looks at me as I stop with the sunset and goes, no, that way. Time to go that way. Did you actually see it, Vim? Coming up. Cool, let's go. A reminder that it is very much winter, or autumn at least, on its way. Okay, we've got to find a nice view of this moonrise. Let me see if I see it. This is extraordinary. This is so beautiful. The world's best view, but at least we managed to get a clear shot of it coming up above the horizon. Orange, it's bright orange in color from where we're sitting, bright orange yellow color. And it just looks so much larger than it does when it's fully risen. It's an optical illusion, of course, it's not. But this is so beautiful. Taking this opportunity to take in the sounds of the night. that is absolutely too beautiful for words. Just listening to the sounds of the crested franklins going to bed, watching the moon come up. It's taken on that yellowish color because of all of the dust that is at the level of the horizon. So it's only really just the same reason we have such extraordinary sunsets and sunrises. When it's at that low position, the light waves have further to travel, and thus only the longer waves of light actually make it through those, or are not absorbed by the different layers of dust. And that's why we get the pinks and reddy hues and yellow hues of sunsets. It's also why this moon appears so yellow when it is this close to the horizon. As an interesting aside, the mosquitoes are back. I'd be quite happy to just sit and watch it move through the sky. But there are other animals to find, other things to go and do. It's time to go off in search of our whatever gave the monkeys a fright.
Mvula.
Mvula. Vim says Mvula. Let's see if he's right. Darlene, who is watching in New Hampshire and was asking us about telling the difference between male and female hyenas. VM, do you think we could turn on my headlights as well as I go around back past this corner? Thank you. Darlene was wondering, as night starts to fall, and particularly as we've spoken about the fact that the winter is the best time for viewing nocturnal animals, Darlene was wondering, are you managing there? You good? Thank you. Darlene was wondering if we'll ever have a chance to encounter a Cape fox. Darlene, it's unlikely. In fact, it's next to impossible. So Cape foxes are arid species. They occur far further to the west of where we are now. I have seen them before during my time spent in the Kalahari Desert. They are extraordinary little creatures, and the only true species, fox species, that occurs in South Africa. Now, in terms of other animals that we could see out here, that you might be able to see out here, thank you very much, Liam. The closest fox-like animal you would see is a jackal. Now, interestingly enough, the populations of jackal in an area seem to go through peaks and troughs on a sort of 5 to 7 year rotation. At the moment, we seem to be very much in a trough of the animal or of the jackal population. So we don't see all that many, but we definitely do see them on our live drives, both the black-backed and the side-striped jackal. And very much like the foxes in North America and in Europe, they fill a very, very similar ecological niche. They have feed on the same things. They're very opportunistic feeders. They'll feed on insects, small rodents, frogs. They will eat fruit, anything that they manage to scavenge. They will brave lion kills in order to go and feed off the scraps. So that is something that you could see that is very fox-like in appearance, and definitely part of the true canid family, and one that we are always keeping a lookout for. One of my, I don't know if I would call it most embarrassing moments on these live safaris, but it certainly wasn't one of my triumphs, was when I raced away from a leopard sighting because I thought I'd seen a wild dog running past. It was with VM, actually. It was with VM as well. And I was convinced I'd seen a wild dog running past, and it turned out to be a side-striped jackal. At least I suppose it turned out to be something in the end. It's true that we see jackal less often than we see the wild dogs. It's interesting though, because the reserve that I was working at, which is not that far away, we've got so many wild dogs. Oh, wild dogs, what am I talking about? Jackal, I mean. stopping for... Ah, you see, it's just one of those days. I was stopping to show you the call of the nightjar, but it's just flown away. But he's still calling. Beautiful call. I love that sound. It's such a beautiful sound. The sound of summer or African summer nights in the bush that exemplifies the sort of, I have it so closely associated with nights in the bush. It's a beautiful sound. One I find impossible to imitate. I've never managed it. No, definitely not going to work. And Lenny in Pennsylvania, as I drive along and keep an eye out, for example, passing Inyalas, one racing across the road. Lenny has said that whenever I answer a question and look back at camera, they get a little bit concerned and watch the road in front of me just in case. Lenny, it's something that I still am learning to do, and obviously to look back at the camera and to speak to you guys is a crucial part of what we do, because it's our way of talking to you. And it's very important when answering a question, because that is such a personal aspect of the show and the safari, actually, because I would turn and look back at my guests whilst talking. But I must tell you that it's taken me quite a while to get used to the idea, and I do still occasionally miss things. I try not to, though. The one thing that you've got to learn about being an efficient safari guide right from the beginning is when focusing on the road, you don't focus too far or too close, too close to the vehicle itself. You try and scan as far as possible ahead of you. And that gives you, that's because you need to give your brain time to take in actual animals in front or on the sides, and that combined with tracks in the front or in the road. So by scanning far as possible ahead of yourself, you make sure that you don't drive over tracks without seeing them or miss any animals that might be in the bush at the side. And I always tell my, and I've spoken about this before, but I always used to tell my guests to imagine their brain like moving a spotlight, because when we move the spotlight like this, seeing an animal, its eye shine immediately jumps out at us. And I've tried to explain to my guests that that is the way they should go about looking for animals. When you relax your mind, yes, you concentrate on looking, but you don't concentrate specifically on one thing. When you do that, your brain will actually tell you when there's something out of the ordinary, or if there's movement, or if there's some kind of animal. Otherwise, what ends up happening is that you get stopped on a regular basis, or you stop yourself on a regular basis for things like log cats and termite-mound leopards and whatever else your brain might decide to make of them. Something I forgot about, I know that Brent was chatting about this earlier, and he was speaking about... you've got to turn the car off before you take your foot off the clutch. He was chatting a bit, sorry, Liam, try not to throw you off the vehicle. He was talking about ants and things that sting, and he mentioned that I have the insect book, and he wanted me to show you a picture of a velvet ant, which is actually one of the prettiest little ants that we get, wasps that we get out here. I've just got to find it for you quickly. Now, there you go, Ravi. I hope you are still watching. This beautiful little creature down here is called an ant. It is called a velvet ant. It is in fact a wasp. Now the females crawl, only the males can fly. and they will swoop down and grab the female, mate in midair, and then once they are done, just casually drop her. They don't really put her down. They just drop her and leave her to go about her daily business. But just look how different the male and the females look. They look almost like different insects entirely. And then she will go off and find the pupa and larvae of various wasps and other insects and bees and flies and beetles, and she will go and lay her eggs in those larvae themselves. So she's a parasite, a brood parasite, or a parasite of other smaller insect species or larvae. There's spiderwebs trailing all over the camera. So Ravi, that is what a velvet ant looks like. I have sat on one once. I've been stung by them. I wouldn't say it was the most pleasant experience in the world. It's not the worst. But it burns. It burns like a wasp sting burns. There we go. Stopping to just chat a little bit about the velvet ant. Unfortunately, launching the car forward in the process. The nightjars are so vocal this evening. It's wonderful. Just to go back to what I guess must have been my most exciting sighting of the afternoon, that python. Gilly in the UK, Gilly was wondering how long would that python have been dead and would vultures have been feeding on it? Gilly, my guess is just judging by the size of the maggots and the fact that it has been quite cold over the last few days, my guess would be that python has been dead for about 2 or so days. Whether or not vultures would be feeding on it, I don't think so. First of all, because vultures have been largely grounded due to the cold weather, so they haven't been spending as much. That combined with the fact that it was more likely to be found, because from that height they can't necessarily, they have fantastic eyesight, they might have spotted it, but it was more likely to have been found by an animal or a bird species like a battalion or a tawny eagle. Those would be the more than likely the first responders. That being said, it doesn't mean that the vultures will not come and join in. If they start to see other bird species descending and feeding on the ground, they will follow to investigate and then most likely join in on feeding on it. But that's, of course, if a hyena doesn't find it first. Oh, we're going to go. Still no sign of whatever was causing those monkey to alarm call. I'm going to go and check the pan while I do that. Let's find out what Brent's plans are for the rest of the sunset safari.
Look at that absolutely spectacular scene, a dead leadwood with the dying embers of the day behind it. So we've been sitting here, we've also been following up on those alarm calls from earlier. We've been sitting quietly in the dark, trying to see if anything else spots whatever those monkeys spotted, and nothing has alarm called. It has been dead quiet, but very beautiful. We do have a slight bit of bad news. As I turn my spotlight on, it popped the bulb. So we do have some spares. I'm just going to go fetch them, but you're more than welcome to stay with us. We're going to head now back down towards camp to get those spare bulbs, that we might find something on the road. And I wonder what could have possibly killed that python, but we do have something else to show you from those dying embers of the day. We're going to go across to the beginning of the night. Oh, wait, I thought I'd time it perfectly there. Sorry, I went a little bit too far. I was gonna try to go tree to tree. There we go. So, very full moon. behind not a dead Ledward this time, but a dead Knobthorn. Beautiful, beautiful. Now, not the greatest time in the world to be a predator. Clear skies, full moon. A lot of the animals have a slightly better opportunity to spot them before they get snacked upon. So, yeah. It's amazing how that during certain nights, those dark nights, it's really good for the lions and leopards. But nature balances itself out, so they're at a slight disadvantage when there is a bright moon about. So earlier we had a quiz about how many cat species are found in the Greater Kruger could possibly be seen on Juma. A European roller is wondering, isn't a genet a cat species? Not at all, actually. It's a viverridae, so it's far more closely related to mongoose. People have incorrectly called it a genet cat. It is by no means a cat. It is actually, probably the best way to describe it, is a type of a solitary nocturnal mongoose. And so genet is definitely not a cat. There is one other cat species that occurs in southern Africa, and that is called the black-footed cat. But that cat is prefers sort of grassland and desert. So it occurs throughout the Karoo, some of the high veld, and well up into the Kalahari. There are a few other cat species that occur in Africa, but further to the north, you have the African golden cat, which is endemic to the Congo Basin rainforests. And if you go even further north to North Africa, you have creatures such as the sand cat, which is a little desert cat species. Now, Susie in Kansas says, "What is a civet? I've never heard of such a creature before." Well, Susie, a civet is also part of that Viverridae family, the mongoose family. So the closest way to describe it is it's very similar to what a raccoon would be for you guys. So it's like the African raccoon, probably a bit bigger than your raccoon though. And there are two types of civets in Africa. You have palm civets, and you have the African civet. The African civet is a lot bigger and far more terrestrial. The palm civet, or Nandini, is a tree climber, so arboreal, and feeds off palm fruit quite often, but also birds' eggs, baby bush babies, and they occur in more forested areas. But the African civet is a great omnivore, feeding off fruits, insects, small rodents, arachnids, so scorpions, spiders, anything it can find. Great generalist. Nocturnal, probably will come out anytime. Oh, it's been quite light tonight, but anytime from now. And then we'll generally try avoid the really active times of the predators. So the major predators like lion, leopard. So they'll normally get going just after the lions and leopards sort of hunk down for a bit of a snooze, which is normally around after 8 p.m., 8:30 p.m. at night, and then they'll be active through to about 4 p.m. when the lions and leopards get very active again. And that goes the same for a lot of our little nocturnal species. And you probably find the reason that we saw white-tailed mongoose and civet last night is because of the cloud. It had been dark for a bit longer, so maybe the civet and white-tailed mongoose's body clocks were a little bit off. Raisa would like to know if I've ever seen one of those black-footed cats. Raisa, I have been lucky enough to see them. I've seen them quite a few times in Botswana, in the central Kalahari. Very pretty, quite a bit smaller, not tall like an African wildcat, so quite petite. The cat species that plagues me the most that I have not seen, especially after spending a year in the Gabonese rainforests, is the African golden cat. I found their tracks, I found their kills. I just couldn't find one. Managed to find leopards on foot in the forest, but no golden cats. So I think for all the cat species in Africa, I'm probably only missing three or four. Oh, not even that, I think maybe even two. I think it's the golden cat and the sand cat. There might be one other species I might be forgetting, but I don't think so. I can double check. But hopefully in the next couple of years, I'll be able to see both of those species at some point. So we are about to drive into DRC to get a spare spotlight bulb. Be there in about 2 minutes, and then we'll head out again with illumination. So we're about to arrive in camp. So as we go find our spare spotlight, let's jump back across to Jamie. We'll be out again in two shakes of a lamb's tail.
Oh, wow. Brent gets his spotlight bulb. I think I've just come across what looks like it might be a drag mark. It's so difficult to see in at night in this light. Almost completely. Nope, it's not a drag mark. My apologies. It's a terrapin dragging its shell along the ground. I got all excited. I thought we might have found the reason for the monkey's alarm calling in this drainage line system to the north of Galago and Wuyatela. But not today. Listening to the sounds of the night, and I am going to go and stop for that moon again. And speaking of nocturnal creatures, Matthew in Michigan, welcome to our sunset safari. Matthew was wondering. Sorry, Matthew. I've got a short attention span at night because I keep listening to the sounds of the bush. I can hear a Scots owl. It's going to be very difficult to find in the jackalberry tree. Matthew was wondering if we have skunks out here and what that, or a little bit more about what they might be like. Matthew, we don't have any true skunks, but we have animals that are very similar to them and in a very similar family. So in terms of looks, a striped polecat, and I will stop in a moment and show you a picture. A striped polecat looks very similar to a skunk. But in terms of behavior, perhaps a honey badger comes a bit closer in the way in which they behave. So whilst they cannot spray in the same way skunks can spray that foul-smelling odor, they can and do have an anal gland that they are capable of emitting a fairly foul-smelling stench from. There's a couple of different animals out here that all belong to related families to the skunk. So the mongoose also have those anal glands, as do the genets and the civets, as well as the striped polecats. All of them will have those anal glands capable of emitting a strong odor, but not spraying it in the same way that a skunk is able to. Here we go. Took Brent but a few seconds to sort out his spotlight issues. So let's have a look and see how well it's working.
So, fixed and ready to go. So, speaking about civets and little members of the Viviridae family, We did have some luck with them around here last night, so we're gonna go have a squiz. I have seen that civet a few times around our house at Inger's. I'm pretty sure it's possibly the same one we had a glimpse of last night as he dashed across the clearing. Safari Dean is wondering whether a civet is related to a raccoon. He says their faces look the same to him. I'm not sure. I don't know my North American mammals that well. I'm not sure what family raccoons fall under. Why don't you guys check for me? Tell me, what greater family does the raccoon fall under? Is it a Viverridae? If it is a Viverridae, then it is definitely a relative of the civet. I would think, what do you think, Jean-Dre? Do you think a raccoon's a Viverridae? I think so. So they might have a common ancestor way back when, but I'm not 100% sure. The one major difference between civets and raccoons is that I knew raccoons are quite fond of water and they'll swim and eat crabs and all sorts of things, whereas our civets not so fond of swimming and that not. I definitely prefer to keep their toes dry. I spotted an eye in that little thicket there. This is where that guy might be sleeping during the day. So this is where we do see him quite often, just around the entrance to our house. I did catch a flash of a little eye in this little monkey orange thicket, but I can't see anything now. So what we'll do is we're gonna do a loop back down towards the Juma Pan and the Gari Dam and see is anything there. There we go. Thank you, Final Control. Raccoons are Potoprochion lata, I hope I'm saying it right. So therefore not related to Viverridae, so not related to mongoose and civet. Now there is possibly quite an interesting case of parallel evolution. And we can see it in quite a few species that have evolved in different areas. And the raccoon and civet may have very similar diets and similar habits, but they've evolved separate from each other, but to fill a similar ecological niche. Now, another great example of that is the African fish eagle and the American bald eagle. So, completely white head, dark brown body, the same coloration. Obviously, the American bald eagle is a lot bigger, but they also are a type of fishing eagle. So, related to the Stella's fishing eagle and that. But very interesting how that they have evolved very similar characteristics while evolving in completely different places. So Ryan is wondering, do we get crowned eagles in the Sabi Sands? Ryan, it is possible, but highly unlikely. I personally have never seen one, and if we are, it's more than likely you're going to see them around the big river systems, like the Sabi or Sand River. They prefer slightly more forested areas than what we are, but I have personally never seen a crown eagle in the Sabi Sands. I've seen them in Kruger, but only up in the north in Pafuri. But I've never seen them anywhere else in Kruger or the Sabi Sands. I think there's probably a handful of records, maybe three or four, for the Sabi Sands. Big hello to Jane, who's on Twitter. She says she's so thrilled to find Safari Live. It reminds her of her time in the Serengeti. Well, Jane, this is a little bit thicker than Serengeti, but great to have you on board. And don't forget, we'll be out looking for the wonderful beasts of Africa again tomorrow on the Sunrise Safari. And there is a little beast of Africa. He's a bit far. You got him there, Jandre. There he is. Oh, he's moving up. Oh, a bit far from the road. There was a little bush baby, but he's done a disappearing act. Okay, so this is where we had the white-tailed mongoose out feeding on these open areas here last night. So that's what we're going to come check for now. Mustn't neglect the other side. There could still be a beastie there. I can hear a little Scots owl. Sounds like, where does he sound like he is? In that jackalberry. Let's go see if we can find him. One of my favorite little nocturnal birds. No mongooses and whatnot about, so let's look for an owl. Sounds like he's either in that Timbuti or the jackalberry. In New York would like to know, is a dwarf mongoose an omnivore or a carnivore? It is an omnivore, but it is a member of the family Carnivora. So they will mostly eat insects and things like that, and little rodents, but they do also eat fruits. Ravi says doesn't see a huge amount of fruit trees in this area. But Ravi, speaking of fruit trees, we've got... Oh, I got a bug in my ear, sorry. You really don't want them to get in because it is quite painful when they buzz inside your ear. So there's a little worry. They produce fruit. I think maybe, Robbie, you're not seeing big fruit, but I think they produce tiny little berries that are fed on. This big jackalberry off to the left here produces a very tasty fruit, but also very small. Actually, one of civet's favorite trees to feed off fruits is the jackalberry. And even jackals have been known to eat jackalberry fruit. Imagine that. That's where they got their common name. Unfortunately, it sounds like those little owls are a bit too far down into the drainage in that Timbuti tree at the back there. Okay, let's continue to check. Let's just have a quick look off the dam wall, see what is out and about. Well, unfortunately, very quiet this evening. Genevieve, who's in New York, said she was looking at pine cones at home in America and wondered what tree in this part of the world produces the biggest fruit. A few of them produce quite nice big fruit. The baobab produces fruit of about this size, but the by far the champion of the fruit challenge in this part of the world is the sausage tree, Kigelia africana. And the record for a sausage is about 1.6 meters and weighing in at 9.5. Here is the African sausage tree. Okay, come on, white-tailed mongoose, civet, something out in the open areas. So Safari Dean has gone one step and done a photo comparison between a civet and a raccoon. So have a look at that online. I'm pretty sure that'll be on Twitter. And James Richard said, raccoons are actually in their own family. And I can't remember how to say what that family was called. Now, just off, oh, sorry, Inyard. Procyonidae, there we go. So very interesting, but definitely an argument for some parallel evolution there. So this is where we spotted the civet last night, but the likelihood of him being in the same spot is not good. So after a busy night of little critters last night and big critters, this evening doesn't seem to be that busy. One last gander across the quarantine clearings. So, thanks for joining us on this sunset safari. Unfortunately, those lions did depart down to the bugs everywhere to the south. Hopefully they'll pop back north, and hopefully our Karula drought will be broken soon. So for the last few minutes of drive, let's jump back on with Jamie, but don't forget to join us for the sunrise safari.
A quick and respectful hello to the other side and the secret side of the industry flying above us. The anti-poaching team hard at work as we all get ready for our to go head across to our warm and comfortable beds. They will be out all through the night protecting the animals that we love out here. Not an easy job, not a safe job, but definitely one that we thank them all for their tireless service in working towards. Nice to just stop and acknowledge them. They're just, I think, at the moment, out on patrol, checking for any mysterious activity that might be occurring. And as we draw to the end of a fairly quiet sunset safari, nevertheless, we've had some lovely elephant action, as well as that mystery of the dead python that we encountered, or that Steph found for us. Tomorrow morning, I think we'll definitely be starting off in a search to see if we can't figure out what was causing those alarm calls and if there's any leopards moving about in the area. As the soil starts to dry out after the rains, we will be able to get more and more back into tracking down the animals that we know and love. And of course, there's always the possibility, with all of the vocalizations of the male lions over the last 2 days, that the Birmingham boys might decide to rejoin us on Juma once again, responding to the calls of the Salates up in the north. And as we draw now to a close, a big thank you to Viam, as always, for his fantastic and on-point camera work, as well as to Jerry and Louise, the lovely ladies in final control, and the dulcet tones that come through in our ear and feed through all of your questions and comments. And on that note, a big thank you to you all for joining us and to sticking on the back of our vehicle, sending through your questions and your comments that, as I've mentioned, are so fantastic. Join us for the Sunrise Safari. Have a fantastic day wherever you are in the world. Bye-bye.